Wes Mitchell is president of the Center for European Policy Analysis, CAPA. He's a co-founder of the Institute and has played an active role in CAPA's development as the only US think tank dedicated to the study of Central and Eastern Europe. I understand, Wes, you will hold a conference here in Romania next days. Romania is now electing its new president. What would US and Western partners' expectation from the next president of Romania?
Well, I think the expectation in the transatlantic community is in this election to see Romania revalidate its credentials as a democracy and a member in good standing of the Euro-Atlantic community. And I think the elections will be a very important test for Romanian democracy. This is there is a good chance that one party in Romania will come out of these elections with overwhelming strength in the parliament, the presidency, the government. And I think the test will come after the elections and what that party does with that accumulation of power and influence.
Do you know what we saw at the first round of this election? We saw a lot of people voting for those parties full of corrupt politicians, but they did not vote for someone, for example, who's fighting for justice and for the rule of law. How do you explain that?
Well, I think that there are candidates in this election in Romania who are fighting for accountability and transparency and the rule of law. I think within the Romanian context, you have a consolidation and fragmentation of the political scene that's been underway for some time now that is similar to what you see in other parts of Central Europe. I think Viktor Orban and Victor Ponta are very different. I want to say that up front. I think it's important to understand the differences between Hungary and Romania. Viktor Ponta has not used the power of the state to curtail the freedoms of media or religion, has not declared the death of liberal democracy in Romania. Nevertheless, I think this election will be an important test of the current government and presumably of the future president's commitment to democracy. I think Viktor Ponta will have opportunities, abundant opportunities, in the years ahead if his party wins this election, to demonstrate his commitment to transatlantic values and governance, and we assume that he holds these values dear. I think the things to watch most closely after the election are to monitor the status of anti-corruption legislation, particularly the law on pardons and amnesty. And secondly, to the functioning of the integrity institutions, ANI and DNA.
Let me tell you, if we are talking about Viktor Ponta, what The Economist just wrote yesterday. They wrote that Viktor Ponta, once he becomes president, is likely to consolidate his power base and reorient Romania's foreign policy towards Russia and China, much as Viktor Orban has done in Hungary. Is this a real concern inside the U.S. administration, as far as you know, of course?
Well, I think it's an inherently dangerous situation in any country when you have an accumulation of the power and influence of the state in the hands of one party. And I don't mean that as a criticism of any individual party in Romania. I think it would be inherently dangerous in any country, and we've had that at times in the history of the United States. I think in the Romanian context, it's important to keep the differences between the Romanian and Hungarian cases in mind. Romania is not Hungary. Again, Viktor Ponta is not Viktor Orban.
Even if Victoria Nuland, in a speech, she...
At a SEPA conference?
A SEPA conference, of course. She said something about leaders from Eastern Europe, and we understood that she was referring directly to Viktor Ponta and Viktor Orban. It was crystal clear for her.
Right. Well, I think Assistant Secretary Nuland can speak for herself, but I think it's fair to interpret her concerns as applying to the entire region and not to one country or leader in particular. I think democracy in our time faces a test. And I think that Romania is a battleground state in an unfolding chapter of history and will face the tests of democracy more acutely than many other countries. I think what is happening in Hungary deserves to be described for what it is, which is a recidivistic and anti-Western impulse that is drawn towards the example of Russia, but also the corrupting influences of Russia. I think that temptation exists in other states in Central Europe. Surely it must exist in Romania. But Romania, I would venture to say, has stronger Atlanticist moorings than Hungary. I think Atlanticism as an organizing force is stronger in Romania. I think it's a healthier polity in many ways, with a healthier civil society. So I'm optimistic for Romania, even with the challenges, but I think it's important to see the challenges for what they are, and I think they're growing stronger.
As you mentioned, Romania is surrounded by countries where Russia already has a big influence in Hungary, in Bulgaria we can see this influence, in Ukraine, of course. How would you define Romania's status right now in the region?
I would say Romania is an island. It's an island of democratic governance and Euro-Atlantic ideas and institutions. It's an island of Atlanticism strategically and of American military influence and Western political and economic presence. I think it's an embattled island. I think in some ways the West is already at war in our time with ideas of authoritarian organization of government that are in vogue in some large Eurasian states. And I think that creates a temptation to flirt with certain hybrid forms of governance. Now, Romania is an embattled island. It's a very viable island to the United States and to the Western alliance. I think it's precisely because Romania is an embattled island that it is all the more important that it have a strong immune system at the level of governance and corruption. Precisely because the geopolitical environment is worsening, you have to expect that the most successful democracy in the Balkans will face greater tests. There are external forces that would use the unfinished business of your democratic transition against you actively. And I think this is growing worse by the year. And this makes corruption in any state, but particularly a frontier state of NATO, a national security problem as much as a governance problem.
If I were Putin right now, I would like to conquer that island.
Certainly you would. It would be a very tempting prize. I would go further and say, I think we've made the mistake in the West in the period since the onset of the Ukraine crisis in focusing most of our attention on Poland and the Baltic states for obvious reasons. But from a Russian revisionist standpoint, the southeast of Europe, a southeastern strategy recommends itself. From a Russian revisionist standpoint, you've already made military offensives deep into eastern and potentially soon to be southern Ukraine. You have Odessa, Moldova is teetering on the brink, Transnistria see, and Gagauzia see Crimea as a precedent. All of the influences that you talked about in the West, Western Balkans, Hungary is tilting east, Bulgaria is in a state of virtual state capture. And to your east, you have a nation that was moving closer to the European Union that's been invaded without any meaningful response from the Western community that would dissuade Putin from doing otherwise elsewhere on the frontier. So from Putin's standpoint, if you have the option of moving in terms of influence or maybe even in military terms in the north of Central Europe, you have a phalanx of opposition from Poland and the Baltic states, very well-organized opposition. In the south, much of your work is already done for you, and I think that's where the insidious nature of revisionist and anti-Western and irredentist Russian-backed influence has created a problem of generational magnitude for the West in this region.
But don't you think that it's a hard task for a country like Romania to become a model of democracy? Because as you may know, every single day we have an investigation announced by the prosecutor. Every single day a politician, a high-ranking politician, is arrested or investigated. How can Romania could become a model of Western democracy in the region?
Well, Dan, I think you already are. I think you already are a model of Western democracy in this region. And we started by talking about the challenges that Romanian democracy faces. And I believe that you're in a community of values where you should be honest about those challenges. But I think that Romanians should also recognize the tremendous strides that they've made as a democratic nation state in the last 25 years. Romania has come from being one of the poorest and most wretched and most oppressed of the captive nations of the Soviet bloc to one of the most successful and fastest growing economies in this region. You've attracted $50 billion in U.S. foreign direct investment from the United States alone since 1990. Your democratic institutions, I take great confidence in the anti-corruption institutions that have been established in Romania. I think that they have to be protected and tended, but it's important to point out the good work that's being done. I think that I'll speak very bluntly and say that I think the prosecution of the president's President Băsescu's brother is an indication that you have a functioning judicial system. So I think there are points of light, and I think Romanian democracy deserves to be praised for the progress, the very real and difficult progress that you've made. And you should guard that progress.
We were talking about Russia and Putin and his will to recover his influence in the region. Which are the real threats coming from Russia concerning Romania, if you want to elaborate a little bit more?
Well, I think Romania exists in a tough neighborhood. And I think there are certain conditions that need to be present in order for Romania to thrive economically and politically internally. You have to have certain external conditions. You need the Black Sea to be an open economic space. You need Russian influence as much as possible to not go west of the Dniester River. You need a strong, active Western presence, a security anchor. You need ethnic irredentism to be contained in the Danubian basin. And I would stop with those four. By the way,
we saw an analysis saying that probably Russia, Putin, would try to use Hungary in order to destabilize Romania using the minority problem in the Transylvania. Do you think it's possible to
happen? I think it's entirely possible. I think the old genie of ethnic irredentism in the Danubian Basin has been let out of the bottle for the first time in a couple of generations, perhaps since the 1940s. Romania will always be a net loser to irredentism run amok in this region. Romania was the largest beneficiary of the post-1919 settlement. Romania is a composite country that includes lands which other revisionists, large or small, in some not so distant future could express desires for. And that may seem like old history, but I think Putin has made it current history. And Crimea is a very dangerous precedent. It creates a demonstration effect that populist and irredentist nationalism across this region would look to imitate. I would list that as one of the, to answer your question, I would list that as one of the top near-term national security threats facing the Romanian state if you're talking about external problems. I would also include the remilitarization of the Black Sea. I think in our lifetimes we're witnessing a gradual return to conditions in the Black Sea by which the force of a large power is an arbiter of outcomes and maritime economic zones rather than international law. I would add a third. If there were three, I think the third would be increasing military pressure on Romania's eastern frontier and the prospect of rekindling a frozen conflict in Moldova, Transnistria would be manifestly not in the interest of the Romanian state strategically.
Do you see, Wes, an energetic dispute with Russia over the Black Sea resources? Because you say that the militarization in the region is increasing.
We've seen things in our lifetime, and we've seen things in the last 8 months that many lifelong analysts of this region predicted would never occur. So I think we should broaden the horizons of the scenarios that are possible. And I think one of those would be a Russia that looks at the Black Sea as a resource zone in part, but also an area in which it can conveniently hamper and impede very fragile Western and Romanian resource strategies. I think if Russia is revisionist, a revisionist power on land, we have to assume that Russia would be a revisionist power at sea. And the 2009 exclusive economic zone is not something that we can assume will never be challenged. Now that Crimea is under new sovereign management, I think Romania should prepare itself on the threat horizon for challenges to its economic legal challenges to its economic exclusive zone, and to increased maritime military pressure, Russian military aircraft and vessels harassing international oil companies, management of oil rigs or other Romanian interests. I think all of these are plausible and maybe even likely in the not so distant future.
We already saw that fights and planes invading the European airspace. And by the way, NATO official Philip Breedlove, the NATO commander in Europe, just said that NATO must temporarily supplement its military presence in Eastern Europe. What does this imply for a country like Romania? More American troops, more weapons, extra military bases across the country?
Well, I think it implies that the United States has to rejoin with all of its heart and mind the battle for influence in Southeastern Europe. And I think we've lost the first several rounds of that game before we even woke up and realized that a geopolitical contest was underway in this region. I think the military dimension is an important but not only dimension to that contest. And specifically within the military realm, I think some of the steps that have already been taken are a move in the right direction. Romania is a frontier state. You will face the pressures of a frontier state. I think it's in Romanian and Western interest to have a strong U.S. military presence here. I think the important thing going forward in U.S. policy is that that become a permanent presence that includes air rotational assets modeled on those that we've done with the Poles, and that the United States, the broader U.S. posture in Europe, let's say the United States needs to conduct an intra-European pivot. We've pivoted to Asia, but I think we need to pivot back to Central and Eastern Europe.
Could we say, Wes, that because all of this that you mentioned, Romania is or will be in the future the battleground state between U.S. influence and Russian influence?
I think you're a battleground state now. And I think it's a battle for the future of Western ideas at a very fragile, a very dangerous moment in global history where we see renewed ideological and geopolitical competition worldwide. And the good news is that Romania has the foundations to succeed in that battle. I think what the West will need most from Romania in the years ahead is something that Romanians haven't had to think a lot about in the past few years because it's been such a tranquil environment, and that's strategy and leadership. A Romania that embraces its role, the role that geography has given it, as being at a crossroads in the war of ideas and in geopolitical terms, but embracing that role and projecting the influence and confidence of a democratic Atlanticist, soon to be energy exporting ally of the Western order. And I think that that's that will be hard work, but I think Romania is up to that task. I think the last 25 years have given you the ingredients that you need to succeed.
Thank you very much, Wes Mitchell, the president for Center for European Policy Analysis.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you.